Houston, come in. This is Lunar Gateway. Come in, Houston. No reply, just like every other time. I throw the receiver in disgust, the weightless environment causing it to float mockingly in front of my face at the end of the retention strap. I am bathed in the soft red glow of emergency lights that serve to illuminate every inch of my tiny cell. I take a deep breath to calm my nerves before returning to fiddle at the maintenance panel. I've been in here for 2 weeks now. This station was designed as the successor to the other space stations, like the famous ISS. But since the deorbiting of the ISS, humanity had trouble coming up with another similar mission. The main goal for this station was to take us closer to the moon. It was meant to serve as a solar-powered communications hub, science laboratory, short-term habitation module, and holding area for rovers and other robots. We built it so that one day we could not just build lunar settlements, but to create an easy way for us to go to Mars. Fuel efficient, fast, not dependent on weather conditions on Earth or costs of rockets. Typically, there's a minimum 2 crew on board at any one time, but we weren't sure if it was ready to host humans just yet. I was supposed to be out of here 3 weeks ago with the British and the Chinese astronauts. They came here with me, but unfortunately, the replacement had some mechanical complications. And then the nasty weather in Moscow delayed the launch by another week. Even so, they should have been here days ago.
Are you sure you'll be alright here by yourself, mate?
Sure, somebody's gotta keep the lights on. Besides, the Ruskies will be here soon. Just have a drink for me when you get landside, okay?
Oh, I expect I'll have 2. Godspeed.
I was ready to spend 7 to 10 days by myself on the station, waiting for the Russians to get their act together and get me my ride home. I'd done some time in isolation chamber before, especially during my training, so I kind of knew how to handle being stuck in a confined space with myself. The trick is usually not to listen to the voices. The voices can drive you crazy. The station itself isn't roomy, but it has 5 different modular compartments. More than enough space for one person not to feel enclosed. Even better, every module except for the emergency cell has specially reinforced portholes, providing a magnificent view of the Earth on the one side and the moon on the other. And it was really these photos of the breathtaking panorama that had first driven me to join the NASA program. This was 20 years ago. So what better way is there to spend a week than by gazing at the world in all of its glory? Since our planned experiments were complete, other than the basic maintenance, that's exactly what I spent the first several days doing. And honestly, I could lose myself for hours watching the dark gray fields of the moon below me, the fields which once in a while would break open with the view of our beautiful blue ball. I remember seeing the images of the so-called Earthrise from the Apollo missions. And this alone was enough for me to want to one day become an astronaut. These images, though taken long before my time, were inspirational, beautiful, majestic. I would never believe it back then that one day I would experience the same. Being the so-called loneliest man in the world, as it was referred to back then, when Michael Collins on the Apollo 11 mission was left to be the sole member of the Apollo capsule, as the other astronauts landed on the moon. He did not see it as being lonely, he saw it as being alone, together with the universe. I always wondered how I'd feel about this as well, and in some sense it did feel the same, until that one day when the event occurred. 5 days into my lonely vigil, I'd been roughly awoken by a blaring alarm. Houston was trying to reach me, and they needed me now.
What's going on, Houston?
Lunar Station, we're having some weird readings. Satellites registered some sort of an anomaly, we're just now picking it up. Don't know if it's a solar flare, or some kind of a field left behind by a passing comet, or something else, we'll get back to you. We'll be moving into the area within the hour. There is no telling how the systems in the stations are going to respond, so it'd be best if you buttoned up in the emergency cell until we're through. We'll let you know when to get out.
How long will that be?
Currently we don't know, but we'll be in touch.
It was a good advice.
Alarm started blazing almost exactly 60 minutes later, and abruptly whole section of the station instrument panels started shutting down. I was able to keep track of everything that was going on from the master controls in the emergency cells, so I knew exactly when power to the station completely cut out. There was a tense 5 to 10 seconds before the emergency batteries kicked in, and then with a soft whine, they powered up the red lights I'd been basking in ever since. I pause my work at the maintenance panel. For the thousandth time, I take out a photo of my wife and daughter. They're both smiling, holding each other close. Are you going to space again, Daddy? Yes, honey. But not for long this time. But I don't want you to go. Don't worry, I'll be back before you know it. The emergency batteries are designed to provide minimum function, pretty much just the life support and basic communications. I should, in theory, be able to receive any transmissions from Houston. Theoretically, they should also last long enough that I'll have to be more concerned with running out of food and recycled water before worrying if they're going to run dry. But I'm blind and deaf in here. The communications are very rudimentary, designed to run on almost no power. So it's a small wonder I haven't been able to reach Houston. I have to do something. I can't even see outside. The emergency cell was designed specifically without any kind of a viewport, with walls thick enough to survive any cosmic radiation. The walls are starting to close in though, I can feel it. In a cell this small, there's not much room to shrink. At least, the voices are not here yet. I don't hear anything. But as I was always told, the trick is to always avoid them. Don't listen to them. In here, there's nowhere to run though. Nothing to distract my mind. The main system is powered by exterior solar panels. This system has been tested and retested to automatically restart in the event of catastrophic failure. But when it actually counted, something stopped the reset. After a day or two, I decided to take matters into my own hands. I tried to pop the cover of the maintenance panel. After 2 weeks, I've gotten exactly zero response for my efforts. It wouldn't budge. As I put the photo of my family back in my pocket, the fear and unfairness of it all momentarily got the better of me. Damn it, I was supposed to be home weeks ago. In frustration, I hit the communications panel as hard as I could with my open hand. Amazingly, that did the trick. With a click and a whir, the red lights shifted to white, and the instrument panel began powering up to the fully operational state. Ecstatic, I threw myself across the cell to the communications array. Houston, Houston, come in. This is the Lunar Gateway. Houston, can you hear me? I tried the line for 20 minutes. There was no response. What the hell is going on? A gnawing pit was growing in the base of my stomach. While the system was down, I could make excuses for the radio silence, but now, what's happening? And even though before, the lack of communication kept my panic from setting in, now, I didn't know what to feel. I had to get out of this stupid cell. I may not be able to talk to the people on Earth, but at least I can watch them. If I imagine hard enough, maybe I'll see my little girl, coming from behind the moon with every Earthrise, look into the skies to see if she can spy the station as it passes close to the moon. I unseal the airlock and move to the next module. Being able to move out of this cell made me feel overjoyed. I even laughed to myself, maybe I'll be able to see my replacement shuttle, docking right now. I peered through the viewport, then frantically I moved from module to module, looking through each porthole in turn. That pit that was growing inside my stomach was growing even deeper with each passing moment. Listen, Ian, she doesn't want you to go. She's a kid, of course she doesn't want me to go. But I don't want you to go either. I know, but I know you will anyway, and I won't stop you. I love you, babe. I love you too. Always. And forever. It takes the station's computer 2 hours to analyze our position. It keeps looking for those familiar stars and pulsars that we've always used for decades to triangulate where we are. It fails. 2 hours pass. It fails again. In my gut, I had already known something is up. I'd known when I looked through the viewport and did not see the big, beautiful Earth shining at me, or the gray lunar fields below me that I'm so used to by now. just the dark, empty blackness of space, filled by only a few lonely stars, stars that I wasn't really familiar with. Something was odd with the rest of the galaxy. It was off. Way off. As if the time and space froze around the station, while the rest of the universe continued expanding and moving away. In that moment, everything became clear. I knew I could never go back. I knew I was the loneliest man in the universe. I'm sorry, Ellen. I'm sorry I can't come back.